Of spin zero fields, massless, massive scalar fields, and we'll go through some other properties and extend a little bit the theory we worked on last time. First of all, I want to review general features. This is what I'm going to say now is valid also for more general fields, not just for scalar fields. And it has to do with the way quantum fields transform under symmetry. So I remember the beginning of the course, we started the classifying fields on the way they transform under Lorentz and Poincaré symmetries, and then we explored also the effect of other symmetries, like charge. We constructed symmetries on as basically transformations that were mapping field configurations to other field configurations, and in particular mapping solutions to solutions of the equation of motion. Then we said, okay, now we quantize the theory, and our fields now do not describe the state of the system, but they are operators, which actually are associated to a measurement of the field. And the state of the system is instead described by the wave function on the Hilbert space. So accordingly, the quantum theory, symmetry will act on the state itself, transforming the configuration described by the state in the Hilbert space to a new configuration of the Hilbert space. So at the quantum level, the system is described by some wave function, and the action of a symmetry will act directly on the Hilbert space, mapping the wave function to a new wave function, which is the transformed one. So the action is linear, and it can be proved that if the symmetry group is compact, the action of a symmetry is represented by a unitary transformation on the Hilbert space. A unitary transformation automatically preserves probability amplitude, so that the symmetry indeed preserves probability amplitude, so a symmetry will not change the result of a measurement. Now for Poincaré symmetries, the Poincaré group is non-compact. There are translations, and Lorentz symmetry also is a non-compact group. The metric is not positive definite. So in general, you will expect that this implementation is not true. In particular, the transformation are not represented by unitary transformations. It can be proven that any symmetries can be represented by either unitary or anti-unitary transformations. And in fact, the full Poincaré group is represented in general by an anti-unitary transformation. But if we restrict ourselves to proper Lorentz transformations, which are non-compact but a subgroup of them, they can still be represented by unitary transformations. So the Poincaré group, restricted to proper Lorentz transformation, is still represented by a unitary transformation on the Hilbert space. And in fact, you will see that only a discrete part of the total Lorentz group, which has to do with the time reversal parity, requires anti-unitary transformation. And we will describe what the anti-unitary transformation is and how it acts when we encounter it, okay? So for the moment, we can restrict them to unitary transformation, which are enough to describe the whole Poincaré group restricted on proper Lorentz transformation. Okay, so we'll not touch it in this way of implementing the symmetries, I will not touch the field operators anymore. I will only transform the states. This is one choice. You could make another choice in which you leave the states untransformed and you only transform the operators. And they are equivalent. And they indeed corresponds one-to-one to Schrödinger picture and Heisenberg picture in the evolution of time. And we will see indeed that this is how Schrödinger picture and Heisenberg picture emerge naturally just by this type of transformation for the symmetries. Okay?
When you say evolution, you mean obviously you mean time evolution, right?
Time evolution,
so yes. Can you have a quantum field theory without a notion of time?
Yes, that's a Euclidean quantum field theory, where the notion of time is intrinsic in the metric itself. From the fact that the metric has a signature, which is 1 minus 1 minus 1 minus 1, so there is a different signature in different components, it makes the second order equation of motion hyperboloid. So there is the second order differential equation is of this time. And because of this sign, you have a concept of evolution in time. If this time will be like this, then there will be no evolution in time, because then you cannot really differentiate time and space. You have just four spaces. So the whole point of time is different, which is different exactly because of this. Don't ask me why the signature of the metric is there. It's just what it is.
So that the transformations of the fields that keep the Lagrangian invariant are the same as the transformations on the states? What and on?
Yeah, now we'll see how the transformation on the states corresponds to the transformation of the fields we talked for classical fields. Okay.
So if I say that, okay, what is necessary for a quantum field theory, then we can say that we should have a manifold and a Hilbert space and a vacuum vector and local observables. That's all. Or do we need something else? And a representation of the observables on the Hilbert space.
All you need is Hilbert space with, the same requirement of normal quantum mechanics, plus the notion of locality.
And the Hilbert space should have a vacuum vector?
You mean whether the Hamiltonian is bounded from below?
Yeah.
Yes, that is what we like. I'm not sure it's a necessary requirement. It's a necessary requirement if you want a non-sick theory. Mm-hmm. People can discuss, in principle, you can discuss at a mathematical level also cases where the Hilbert space is not bounded from below, or the Hamiltonian is not Hermitian and there is no unitary transformation. There are non-unitary field theories that are discussed in some cases.
So we need unitary representation of the Poincaré group on the field?
Yeah, that is guaranteed by the theory. There is a... Okay. That can be demonstrated. Okay, so let me now be a little bit more concrete. And let's consider now for a general field, phi r of x, in any representation of the Lorentz group, so I'm leaving the index R free. Remember, at the classical level, so if you consider classical field, we were saying that the field was transforming in general S with some matrix, SRS, which was implementing the Lorentz symmetry on the representation of the field phi, and then the argument was transformed this way under general Lorentz and space-time translations. Okay? And this was classical. Now, the quantum level, we're going to implement the same transformation at the level of states. So the quantum field does not transform, the state transforms. But you remember, we also argued that, so if you have a general state psi, and you compute on that state the matrix element of the field itself, the result of this measurement was what we would call the classical field. Okay? So the value of the classical field has to do with what state you put here. Instead, the quantum operator phi is always the same representation in terms of A, the ideas, for example. So now if you perform a transformation at the quantum level, what happens is that the left-hand side of that equation becomes psi prime phi r of x psi prime. Okay, we transform the state. And the right-hand side, we would like to be mapped into this new configuration, which is SRS phi s of lambda minus 1 x minus xi.
What's the relationship between psi and psi prime?
Sorry, class. What is the relation between psi and psi prime? Is this. So it's just, they are connected by a unitary transformation.
So you're assuming that the field itself is not transforming, only the state is transforming?
With this assumption, I'm taking the field phi as an operator to be the same. Mm-hmm. So the operator do not transform under the symmetry, only the states transform under the symmetry. Okay. If you want, it's like the Schrödinger picture. Mm-hmm. Okay. So this is equal to psi, some u dagger, which in general depend on the parameter xi and lambda of the transformation, phi r of x, u xi lambda psi. Okay? Okay, now I can take this guy here and substitute here again this relation here. See? Can just change the argument here and here, so they match with this guy here, and then I replace phi classical with this matrix element. So I'm going to rewrite this as SRS, matrix element of psi, phi s of lambda minus 1 x minus xi, psi. This equality must hold for any state, so I can write an identity at the operator level between the left-hand side and the right-hand side, which is just u dagger phi r of x u equal to srs of phi s of lambda minus 1 x minus. So this characterizes the unitary transformation I had to perform on the state psi to map the field, there would be classical field, the way I want under a Lorentz transformation. So if the unitary transformation U satisfies this relation, matrix element of the field, which represent classical field, will transform as classical fields, the way we use to define the field itself, okay? At the classical level. So this is just an identity between this operator phi and this operator U and U dagger. And SRS is just a number. Okay? You can also invert. Sometimes it's useful to use the inverted relation, which is basically I multiply this equation by U and U dagger on the left and right hand side respectively, and make a change of variable in this calling x, and then you'll have some new variable here, and multiply by s to the minus 1. So eventually you'll get that u phi r u dagger of x is also equal to s to the minus 1 rs phi s of lambda x plus xi. So multiply by s minus 1 both sides, multiply by u and u dagger each side, and then I made a change of variable on both sides. Okay.
Say again?
S is just a matrix of numbers, no operators. So yes, they commute with anything. The only operators here are phi and the u and u dagger.
Just a question of your notation. With some books, when they apply Poincaré transformation to any four vector, they do the Lorentz part first and then they do the transition, but you are doing the transition first and the Lorentz part after that.
Well, you can do independently.
Yeah, but your notation
is it doesn't matter. Yes. It doesn't matter. I mean, it just means that the translation is lambda xi instead of xi.
Because I was confused when you wrote the inverse, because if you do the translation at the end, then the inverse of lambda becomes something like u.
Exactly. Now I have this instead of this.
Yeah, because if you do that, then the inverse of this transformation has to do with minus a lambda and then multiply by this.
Yeah, but it doesn't matter. Yeah, it doesn't matter. Okay. I mean, in this case, it means that this xi prime is equal to lambda xi. Oh,
yeah.
So it's another translation. Is it clear so far? Questions on the procedure? Okay, then now I'm going to use those identities to see what it implies for our real scalar field. Sine of x. Of course, in that case, the equation is further simplified by the fact that S is trivial, it's just identity. So let me just use, for example, this identity here. Now, what I'm going to do is just replace inside the phi r of x, the explicit expression for the field phi that we obtain by solving the equation of motion, quantum method. So here, well, this part is simple, just this, the integral in d3p over 2 pi q, 1 over 2 omega p, and then we have u dagger ap u times e to the minus I dx plus the Hermitian constant, okay? And this is this side. And then I have to equate to this side here. And that's integral in dtp over 2 pi q, 1 over 2 omega p, tilde p, e to the minus I p, and then the argument now is lambda minus 1 x minus psi plus and Lucian conti. I don't like. I should have used the other one. Okay, I keep this. Now let me do a change of variable in P, and here I send P to lambda minus 1p. Okay? So that this integral become, you see this part here, d3p over 2 omega p, is Lorentz invariant. It's the combination you could write as d4p with the delta, the exercise, remember. So this will not change. Here we get a tilde of lambda minus 1p, and here we get e to the minus I lambda minus 1p dot lambda minus 1 x minus xi plus emission function. Now this product here is just px, the scalar, and then I'm left with, so this will become e to the minus I px and then here we get minus plus I lambda minus 1 p times xi. Now, you see that the integral has the same form as the original one here. So these two guys are equal only if I match the coefficients of each exponent in e to the minus ipx, which means that u dot a tilde p nu must match with a tilde lambda minus 1 p tensor phase, which is e to the I lambda minus 1 p dot psi. So I can multiply by u and u dagger, like the second identity here, and also replace lambda minus 1 p with p. So at the end I get a tilde lambda p is equal to u a tilde p u dagger. And let me put the phase on the other side, e to the minus I, p dot xi. Okay. And of course I didn't write explicit Hermitian conjugate, but of course for that you get the Hermitian conjugate relation of that, which means that at this level you get, here you get the Hermitian conjugate of this is u a tilde dagger p u dagger, and on this is e to the I p xi a tilde dagger lambda p. So these are the identities that links the unitary transformation acting on states and the annihilation and creation operator A of P that act on states.
Here, the substrate of A is a free vector, no?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, so it's just the. So lambda acts only on the space.
No, yeah, lambda is a full Lorentz transformation, and of course, you just take the special part of this.
These two transformation laws that you have just wrote, in the past I have some confusion between them, because sometimes it is written that this transformation law actually transforms the pre-existing fields, but that transformation law actually transforms the action of that field in creating all these strong particles. So what is the meaning of this particular statement?
I'm not sure I understood.
The question is that the transformed field should create respite particles at the point, you know, lambda times x.
Yes.
That the second one, transformation law. So that can you say that this transformation law transforms the action of the field in creating respite particles?
Yeah, this is what this is a statement I was trying to make before. So I am acting on this with a symmetry just on states. And then I get just an identity at the level of operators. This is just a useful identity. It's not, you shouldn't see this as the actual transformation of the field. The field do not transform. Only the states transform, and the field automatically satisfies this relation. On the other, this is, if you want, it's like the Schrödinger-like picture. The Heisenberg picture is that the states do not transform, and instead you transform the fields in this way. So under a symmetry transformation, the field transform with the u larger in this way, and it will be equal to this. And now you're transforming the field. And then so either you transform, so you have your field is some operator in the Hilbert space. So either you transform the Hilbert space, or you transform the operator inside the Hilbert space. Okay. You can choose one of the two. Which is encoded not in the matrix element. When you take u and u dagger, you can just see them acting on the states or see them acting on the operator. Okay, so what do we do with these identities? Well, let's see how what they mean for generic states of the Fock space of the scalar field. So let's take, for example, a state of n particle with different momenta. Let's say state with one particle momentum p1, one particle momentum p2, and so on. Could have taken n, it doesn't matter. Okay. This state here, under a under a symmetry transformation, will go into u times itself.
I have one question. The U operator, it acts on the states of the Hilbert space, right? So is U made up of the fields itself?
Because we will see exactly this.
Okay.
So U must act in this way. Now the state itself, remember, was equivalent to a bunch of creation operator out of the vacuum of the particle you need for this state. So they will have some A dagger P1, A dagger P2, until A dagger Pn, acting on the vacuum. Now let me insert between any of these two operators the identity written in U dagger U way. And now I'm going to use the identity above here to rewrite these combinations in terms of this. So for example, the first guy will become e to the I p psi times a tilde lambda p dagger. The second will be e to the I p2 psi times a lambda p2 tilde dagger. Until the last one, e to the I p n psi a tilde lambda pn, and then I'm left with u acting on the vacuum, and but u acting on the vacuum is basically a Lorentz transformation or a translation of a state which is without particle, so it will be automatically Lorentz invariant, so it should map into itself up to a phase that can always be chosen to be zero, for example. And there was a target here. So you see that after you factorize all the phases outside, you get e to the I, the sum of all the momenta dot psi times a, all the same daggers, but creating particle with momentum transformed by lambda. So the state will be lambda p1, one particle momentum lambda p1, one particle momentum lambda p2, one particle momentum lambda pn. So this is indeed what you wanted. You wanted the state to be Lorentz transformed into the state with momenta which are transformed by the Lorentz transformation. In this case, since these are plane waves, the translation is sort of trigger, it just acts as a phase. Okay? Since plane waves are e to the I px, the translation in x is just produce a change of the phase of the plane wave. And the shift of the phase is just related to the total momentum of the state.
All the momentum here are spatial momentum.
Yes, all this, well, yes, the since these are real particles, the four momentum of the particle is completely determined by the three special momentum because the mass is fixed, so the energy is fixed in terms of three momentum. Of course, you may think of this as four momenta, and then it's from the four momentum. Now you can see that, for example, if you only consider the translation, the action of this unitary matrix corresponds just to produce a phase to the state, and the phase, so if I only consider translations, the action of the unitary transformation is just to produce a phase which is proportional to the transformation parameter itself, times the total momentum of the state. But the total momentum of the state is extracted by the momentum operator, P, dot, sorry, P mu, and X mu. So I can conveniently write the representation of the operator in the Hilbert space of translations in this terms, in terms of the operators that generate translations, which is the momentum operator, mu, acting on any space.
In configuration space?
Huh?
Because here we are in phase space, so...
In phase space, number. This is the total p mu.
If it's an operator, then it will be in the configuration space, so it acts.
No, it's not a local operator. This is a total charge. It's the integral in d3x, yeah. Of is what is conserved. It's what it acts on a state returns the momentum. So this p mu, if you remember, was the integral in d3x of t0 mu of x, which was the integral in d3x for the scalar field, phi dot I grad
after it acts, it gives us what
is. Yes, yeah, because you remember, if you rewrite this in terms of creation relation operator, you get this, that is integral d3p over 2 pi q, 1 over 2 omega p, times p, well, p mu. Sorry, this is the total p mu, so the, here there was a p mu. No, there was also a g minus g mu 0, but there is an extra piece. P mu, and here there is a tilde dagger p, a tilde p. So this is a number operator weighted with the p mu. So you see that if you act with this operator on the stage of the n particles, you will just count how many particles at that momentum and produce a phase proportional to that momentum.
In quantum mechanics, we were saying that p called rpx, this translates the psi of x, because actually p is just partial of partial x, so it's the generator of translation.
Yes.
But then we're acting on state, a function of momentum, not on position.
Yes.
So I have a confusion, because here we're considering the same p as translating the psi of p.
We will see, yes. Let me, yes. We will see exactly this in a moment. Okay. Now let's put this in the identity, which, let me put, for example, use this one. So now this identity becomes e to the I p xi phi of x e to the minus I p xi equal to phi of x plus.
This U is true just for translations.
This is only translation. Yeah. Now I'm focusing on translation. Then we'll discuss the Lorentz transformation. So for translations, this is what happens. So you have this identity. Now you start to recognize something. See, let's look at a translation only in time. So this will become e to the I, p naught, but p naught is Hamiltonian, times time, phi of t. E to the minus I, sorry, we can put 0, for example, h t is equal to 5.
This is a kind of evolution of the operator.
Yeah. Okay. So this is just a statement that this field of these operators here are in the Heisenberg picture, and they evolve exactly like you expect. And in this sense, h now is the generator of time translations. In fact, you can tell respond, for example, this relation as small time. If you do that, a leading order, here you get phi naught equal to phi naught. At the next order, when you bring down here small times, you get either contribution, which is I h phi minus phi h I h time. So you will get
commutator of h,
the commutator I, the commutator of h with phi or not, phi naught. And here, if you tie or expand, you will get d phi dt. And now you find the usual Schrödinger equation, or if you want. The quantization of Hamilton-Jacobi identity for the variable phi.
But this is not true for, I think, just for the Hamilton, I think it's true for every charge.
Every charge, yeah. You can repeat the same things for any symmetry. The representation of the unitary transformation of the symmetry will be e to the I, the conserved charge associated to the symmetry, times the parameter of the transformation. Mm-hmm. And if you tell respond that in that parameter, you'll find that the variation of the field under the symmetry is given by the commutator of the charge with the operator itself. So in this sense, the charge is the generator of the symmetry, because it produces the infinitesimal transformation of the field itself.
if we not restrict ourselves to one target group only, if we have any other kind of...
Yes, we'll discuss also. Yeah, this last statement I made is independent on Poincaré. It's just generic symmetry in charge.
And we don't have to have phi of 0, we can have phi of x in the computer.
Yes. Of course, this identity is translation invariant, so you can make it at any kind. And the same is true for space. So for the space component, you can translate the action of a local operator from one point to the other point by just acting with this unitary transformation on the state. So any field psi at any point can be related to any other point using translations and this unitary transformation. Does this answer your question? No,
because...
Okay, you can now formulate.
Transforming the field, which is a function of x. So e power I p something, this translates the function of x. It's okay, because p is the partial derivative, which generates translation. But this state, which has n particles, it's actually a function of p, not a function of x. So we're translating this state, which is a function of momentum, with the same momentum operator, which is p.
Okay. The momentum space, it will not be partial, it will be just p.
Yeah,
the momentum space.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. So,
but notice one important thing you have to realize is that the very reason that in quantum mechanics the representation of the momentum operator is minus I d in dx, it comes from the fact that x and p as operator have this kind of commutator. And then solving this commutator gives you that the representation of p in x is this. Here, x is not an operator in field theory. So it doesn't make sense to write this as p in the x. The closest analogy of that is that when you expand, you put p here, you take the special part, and you expand for small space translations. In this case, here you get the p operator, and here you get d in the x of phi. Or I can do it in any space here. Here's the best you can get. So in this sense, the action of p on a state is represented by d in the x. But it's different from this. This thing here, acting on wave functions, is now replacing quantum field theory by x, and now is replaced by field itself. P is replaced by conjugate momentum pi itself. And now the wave function is a wave function of fields. So symbolically, you can represent pi as the operator d in d phi acting on the wave function of phi. This is actually the exact analogy of this. But it's typically not useful because phi now is a function, so these are functional derivatives, and to solve the wave function of fields, it's a mess.
When you say, actually, when you say wave function, you mean the expansion of any arbitrary Captain Hilbert space in terms of the eigenfunctions of the phi operator, or just
For me, wave function is just a vector in this space. Then you can choose any basis you want. Maybe it's an abuse of language because wave function is misleading.
Would that be also true for Espinoia field or something like that?
Yes, we will see when we discuss spin 1 alpha and spin 1, we'll do the same exercise and see what happens. But I didn't finish the scalar field because to do the lambda, the Lorentz transformations. Well, in that case, if you do only a Lorentz transformation, all they do is just to transform P in lambda P, the momenta. It can be shown, but I will not do it, that you get that action is represented, as you might imagine, by e to the I epsilon mu nu j mu nu. But j mu nu is the generator of Lorentz transformation. You remember is the integral in d3x of m0 mu nu, and this was the tensor which we got from Nether theorem associated to Lorentz transformation. So it includes both boosts and the three spatial rotations. So on a generic state of any kind, the Lorentz transformation is represented by this in terms of the original fields or creation relation operators, depending on basis you prefer.
Okay. J mu are the conserved charges under the Lorentz fields?
Yes, J mu nu, yes. Just the integral in D3x of the zero component of the three tensor, which was falling from the currents, if you want, the zero component of the currents of the sixth generator. So this is an operator, and these are the six parameters. Any questions? So let me just add a very small exercise. Prove something that I almost implicitly assumed in the derivations of the Green functions for the scalar field, but now using this property under symmetries. So take for example the 0 point function, the 1 point function of the scalar field phi of x on the vacuum. We said this is zero. Well, this was zero for the scalar field with Lagrangian, the one we wrote, right?
Lagrangian metallic symmetry that you said it has.
Yeah, phi minus phi. But imagine I would have given you a shifted Lagrangian. Represented, for example, by this term plus constant, okay? So I added basically a linear term. Now the symmetry is not there anymore. So in general, this guy will not be zero. But you can easily rewrite this example in the example you know by just shifting phi by a constant. So that here you reproduce the square. So you'll have that this term will become phi plus some constant phi naught square, plus again some other constant. And now you call phi plus phi naught phi tilde. This term will not change because it's really value of phi. So you go back up to a shift in phi, you go back to the example you know. So the vacuum expectation value of phi tilde will be zero, because now phi tilde enjoys a C2 symmetry. But phi tilde is related to phi by this relation. So the vacuum expectation of phi will be minus phi naught, right? Anyway, this was just to show you that this in general is not, might not be zero. But what is the most general thing it can be? And for this, you can answer with this, with the transformations. I can use I can use this transformation here. I can add the u dagger u here, where this is a translation. I didn't do anything, right? Added the identity. And this is equal to, well, this is equal to the identity, to the vacuum. This is also equal to the vacuum because it's invariant. And this guy here, shift phi by xi. So let me choose xi equal to minus x, so that this is equivalent to phi at the origin. Of course, here there is no x dependence, so this must be a constant.
But now you're making psi x dependent, you know.
Okay, you ask me to compute this matrix element at a particular x.
Okay, so you do it for only for one particular x.
For that particular x, I found a constant. Then you choose another particular x,
okay.
And I find the same constant.
Okay.
So it's constant in x. In other words, this is the true statement will be that this is equal to this minus xi. So it must be invariant of x. So the one-point function is always a constant, can be at most a constant. What about the two-point function? If you use the same trick, this you can write that this is equal to u dagger on the vacuum is zero, A is the vacuum itself. Here you get u phi of x u dagger, u phi of y u dagger, and the vacuum itself. Now let me choose for the translation minus y, so this goes to the origin, but then this becomes x minus y. Mm-hmm. So this is also equal to a two-point function between phi at x minus y and phi at zero. But this is manifestly just a function of x minus y. So without performing any calculations, in general, this the original two-point function would be a function of x and y. But because of space translation, this two-point function can only be a function of the difference between x and y.
Yeah, our intuition says that this should be a decreasing function of x minus y. So can you prove that somehow?
That depends on the dynamic of the fatigue theory.
For example, in conformal invariance, we can prove that it is 1 over x minus y. Okay, QFT, can we do that?
No.
No.
Well, no. But you can see just by translation invariance that this is equal to the difference. And if you have n point functions, you can always reduce by one and get that the n point function is always the function of the differences of the various points. But this makes sense, right? You computed something that has some n point function, and you translate it. Because of translation invariance on the vacuum, of course, only on the vacuum, you get the same value.
You're only talking about translations right now.
Yes, now we do those work. What happens now if you use Lorentz invariance? So if you use Lorentz invariance, okay, you can do exactly the same manipulations, but now this U represent a Lorentz transformation, so it will map this guy here into the transformed one. So from here you get that this must also be equal to phi of lambda x minus y, phi of 0. Which means that g, this is equal to g of lambda x minus y, which means that this function here must be also be Lorentz invariant. So it must be a function of x minus y squared, which is the only invariant you can construct out of x minus y. And that's indeed why we, when we solved it explicitly, the Bessel function we're finding final solution to be square root of x squared, which was the only Lorentz invariant combination you could construct.
You can also use internal symmetry.
Which symmetry?
Internal symmetry.
You can also use internal symmetry. In a sense, we used them to argue this was zero in that example. Mm-hmm. Now, for the scalar field, there are no other global symmetries.
Complex.
For complex, which we'll hopefully do today later, we'll see how to use it in that case. Okay?
Second one here, when we calculate x equals on phi of x minus xi, I didn't get why this constant is not necessarily zero.
Which constant?
This
is equal to this can be any constant. Now it depends on what theory you use.
Ah, so we're changing the Lagrangian. It's not anymore the Lagrangian we know.
Yeah, yeah. In the Lagrangian we know, this constant is also equal to zero.
Yeah.
But the example I did before, it was to show that in general it can be non-zero. Actually, all these identities are much, much more powerful than the one I explicitly wrote down here for the phi. This identity holds for any operator you write here, any local operators you write here. If instead of, for example, here I could have written the Hamiltonian density as a function of x. Now it's not obviously zero, but this is equal to this, which is equal to a constant. Any other, I could have written or some other operator like phi square of x. Phi square of x now is even under phi minus phi, so you cannot run anymore the argument that must be zero. Indeed, it's not zero, but it must be a constant. In x. Same for here. Let me compute the two-point function instead of phi x, phi y, phi to the 4 and phi to the 6. It's going to take a long time to compute it because you have a lot of A daggers inside. But what I can tell you from the start is that whatever function you find must be a function of x minus y squared. Not of x and y independent. Because I can use all the identities for any operator, any local operator, in any representation of the Lorentz group, not just the elementary field of the Lagrangian. So these are very powerful identities. And they hold also in theories with interactions, not just in the free theory. In the field of interaction, you cannot solve, you cannot even write phi in terms of anything. But you know that the final result needs to constrain by Lorentz and by Poincaré invariant to this constraint.
Aren't they true only for the
scalar? No, no. For of course that one for your scalar. In general, you have also a SR of S here. So in general, of course, here we'll have XI indices. So this will have SI indices, and they also will transform with S. So it's not, they will be modified. There will be some trivial identities, but you have to study case by case depending on the representation of the field. For translation, doesn't matter, right? For translation, S doesn't enter. So the fact that the two-point function, for example, is only a function of the difference of x and y is true for any local field. Any two-point function of two local fields in any representation of this group will give you this result. For Lorentz transformation instead, of course, the answer is not just this. there will be also some prefab that depends on lambda. Yes.
Can we extend this argument to general symmetry that, you know, if you want any quantity to be invariant in any quantum field theory which has some symmetry, then that quantity should be made from the quantities which are remained unchanged after the symmetry, and that is x minus y was given in the case of Poincaré.
Yeah, in this case, because you have only x minus y. Mm. In case you have more, of course, you get less, yeah. More variables, you get less power. Questions about symmetries? Yeah?
When are we going to see this construction put to use? Because all we do now is study the structure, study the endpoint function, and see how we can get it.
There's a lot of struggles. You have to be patient. Be patient. Any other question before I raise?
You said that the unitary representations of Poincaré was only for when we consider proper Brownian's group. If we also consider the reverse and opacity, and our theory was invariant under those transformations, then we also would see that in the two-point function, or?
Yes.
Okay. And in that case, it wouldn't be unitary, it would be anti-unitary, as you said. But the deviation would be something similar?
Yes.
Okay.
But the rest of the transformation which are not proper are just discrete. There is no in that case there isn't an explicit representation in terms of a generator of a symmetry, but you still have a unitary or anti-unitary discrete transformation. So, to have more fun, now we're going to discuss another example, which is a scalar field again, massive, almost free, in the sense that you write probably the most dumb deformation of the theory. Which I can solve. At the level of equation of motion, I'm going to discuss now the scalar field with a source. You remember the classical level, we solved it explicitly. So now I'm going to discuss what happens at the quantum level. So basically, what I'm going to discuss is the theory of with the Lagrangian deformed by just an extra term which is linear in the field and is weighted by a x dependent function j of x. Now just to make useless of the statement I made the previous hour, J of x is an explicit dependence in x, so it breaks Poincaré invariance. So you can write an Hamiltonian, also in this case. And the Hamiltonian looks like 1 half phi dot square plus grad phi square plus m square phi square. And then there is an exotherm which is minus j phi. Integrate over the theories. So let me assume that this function j of x is localized in space and time in some region. So basically, it's like a source that I turn on and off at a certain point, localized in space. And I'm going to study how the system responds. In particular, how the wave function, the state of the system, changes from before the source is turned on to after. Okay. So before the system is turned on, this term is zero. So the Hamiltonian is the one we saw and solved. The solution to the equation of motion are the solution that we already saw before. So the expression for the field is so t less than t source. Phi of x is the usual integral v3 x and dtp, sorry, over 2 pi q. 1 over 2 omega p, a tilde p, into minus I px, plus emission coefficient.
So this is a source that just suddenly appears at some point in time.
Yes. J of x is, in general, is in the Lagrangian, is just a function of space and time. And I'm choosing it to be 0, exactly 0, outside this location of space time.
Okay.
This is just a choice to simplify the discussion, but it's representative of many examples in physics where you have some event happening in time from an infinite interval of time and space. At times after the end, if you want, of the source, at the classical level, you remember, the solution, it was just the free one plus I, the integral of the retarded Green function convoluted with the source. And phi naught was this one. That was already satisfying the initial condition on the state here. Of course, I chose G retarded such a way that it's zero before, so I don't have to change phi naught. I can just use the one before. It was satisfying the initial condition. So if you quantize the theory, you get exactly the same expression, except that now A daggers are operators, but for J it's just a function, so this part is just a function space, which means in terms of operator it are proportional to the identity operator on the Hilbert space. Okay. Remember, G retarded can be written in terms of delta plus and delta minus. So if you replace explicitly the expression, you remember delta plus was the integral, was the same integral in d3p over 2 pi q, 1 over 2 omega p, e to the minus I px, in this case x minus y. And you have to convolute this function here with j, and integrate over d4y. So If you integrate this in Y,
you get the Fourier transform.
You get the Fourier transform from here of J. So, and then here you get basically J tilde of P, the Fourier transform of J. And the rest of the integral is the same form. So when you add sine naught and this, you get an expression which is this, and the A and dagger are shifted by the J tilde, the Fourier transform of J.
So phi of x at t larger than t source, you will have the following form: a tilde of p
plus, so we'll say I here, so I j tilde p. J tilde p is the Fourier transform of j of y in p space. E to the minus I px plus emission conjugate. So basically, we go from this solution holding before the source to a new solution of this form after the source has been turned on and off.
On
the
expectation value is just
checked.
Constant shift.
I mean, yes. And now we can just compute the Hamiltonian, which was this guy here.
The solution is also true for the times when all of the sources in the past.
Yes. Yes. And now I'm going to compute the Hamiltonian by just substituting as before the solution of phi inside here. Of course, at times before the source, you get the usual result. At time after the source, you get an extra contribution from here, and an extra contribution for the fact that inside phi, there is actually now a j. So if you do the exercise, you'll get that the expression for the Hamiltonian is, well, you could have argued even without doing calculations, it's basically the one you already know, but with A and A dagger shifted by IJ. So you get A dagger minus IJ tilde P star times A tilde P plus IJ tilde P. And then there is the extra piece, the divergent piece that has to do with the commutators, remember? This doesn't include J because J is a number that commutes, so it will be the same as before. Eventually, this can drop, right, because it's not causing any physical effects. Okay. Now let's do some physical considerations. Let's look. Imagine you now want to compute and measure the field in some state after the source has been turned on and off. Let's choose the vacuum state. So let's start with the vacuum. Then I turn on and off the source. And then I measure the value of the field on the vacuum after. Okay? So I want to compute the expectation value in the vacuum of the field itself at times larger than the source. Let me do this in the Heisenberg picture. Okay? In the Heisenberg picture, the vacuum do not change in time, but the field change in time, and the evolution of the field in time is just set by solving explicitly the operator as a function of time. which is exactly this. So if you want this phi, which depends on time, is the Heisenberg picture representation of the field phi. Okay. So now you see that this guy here, at times before TS is zero because A dagger on the vacuum gives zero, but now at time after there is an extra piece here, which is non-zero. This extra piece here is nothing else than the integral 2 omega p of jp e to the minus ipx, blah, 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 which are the Fourier transforms of j tilde p, which basically give you back this result here. So this is, you will get this is equal to I g retard x minus y jy, which is just the classical value of the field at times larger than Ts of any x. So as expected, the source created a state psi from the vacuum over which the field assumes what you would have expected for the evolution of a classical field, for the response of, to the source of the classical field. Well, seeing this way is nothing very surprising and illuminating. Let me now do the same calculation, but in the interaction picture. In the interaction picture, the field itself evolves with the free Hamiltonian. Let me call the free Hamiltonian this, H naught. And let me take this as the interaction H1 Hamiltonian. So the state evolved with this free sourceless Hamiltonian. So this, the vacuum state remained the vacuum state of the free Hamiltonian. And the field evolves. The field evolves with just the free Hamiltonian H0. But now the effect of the source is encoded on the evolution of the state. So what happens is that the vacuum in this picture, as time evolves, it maps to a non-trivial state, which is not the vacuum anymore. So let's see what state it evolves to. So our wave function at t larger than ts would be given by the vacuum evolve with the unitary evolution in the interaction picture, which is e to the minus I h interaction dt. So it's e to the I in integral in d t prime until time t of j. Sorry, the return is integral in d3x j of x phi of x. Now this phi in the interaction picture is just the free field, the phi without j, because it only evolves with this fast Hamiltonian. So all the effects of the current now are encoded in this j, they are not in phi anymore. So this is just the integral in d4x, if you want, up to the time t of j phi. And you can substitute phi here in terms of A daggers. And as before, you get integral in d3p, integral in d4x. Integral in d4x gives you the Fourier transform of j tildes. So here, if you do the exercise, you get e to the I integral in d3p over 2 pi cube, 1 over 2 omega p. A tilde p j tilde star p plus A tilde dagger p j tilde p. So all I did was to replace phi with the usual expression without the source, and then made the integral in d4x, which under which only this exponent and j of x, which does just replace the e to the ipx with the fully transformed j.
Again, why did we take phi without the source?
Because in the interaction picture, all the operators, in particular phi, evolve in time job with Hamiltonian without j. Mm-hmm. So the solutions to the field equation for phi would be those without j. So j only appears in the evolution of the space. Okay, so what we got is that the vacuum evolves non-trivial in time, in this picture. In particular, it evolves into a state, which is e to the I, some linear combination of A and Eigers, weighted with the Fourier transform coefficients of the source, acting on the vacuum. Notice that A and Eigers create annihilate particles. So you will have, if you expand this exponent in component, you will get an infinite sum of higher powers, for example, of A daggers and A's, that create more and more particles.
Yeah, can we interpret the Fourier transform of J as the probability of creating a particle with a particular momentum?
You mean JP? JP,
JP delta.
Yes. So the final state, so you start with the vacuum, you turn on the source, and after the source is gone, you'll end up with a state which is not a vacuum anymore, mm-hmm. but is a linear combination of states with different numbers of particles. Actually, it's a state that should be familiar to you.
It's coherent state.
Is the analog of the coherent state of the harmonic oscillator. You remember, the coherent state of the harmonic oscillator can be written as e to the I, some coefficient times A, or A daggers. It's a state which is a linear superposition of particle states. And it's the state that best approximates an eigenstate, for example, for the harmonic oscillator, of the position operator. It's the state that is the most classical state you may think of for an harmonic oscillator, of a state that is localized at some position in X and P, and just evolved with the classical equation of motion for the harmonic oscillator. In this case, it's exactly the same thing, except that instead of X in the harmonic oscillator, we have a field. So this axis should be think of the field. And this is the best approximation to a state that describes a field with a particular value of the field. Of course, you will never have a state which is an eigenstate of the field, because it will not last, because a field does not commute with Hamiltonian. Exactly like in the harmonic oscillator, you cannot have a state that is an eigenstate of the position and will last, because x does not commute with the Hamiltonian. And if you completely localize the position on harmonic oscillator, after a nanosecond, the wave function will spread everywhere. Mm-hmm. Same for the field. If you measure the field exactly well at one time, the time after, the value of the field will be all over the places. Simply because you have maximum indetermination of phi dot, which is the velocity which is field varies with time.
It corresponds to the spreading of the Gaussian wave packet in quantum mechanics.
Yes. You have a wave function also for the value of the field. And if you localize phi extremely well at some time for some value phi naught, it means that you have infinite uncertainty on the conjugate momentum of phi, which is phi dot. You have infinite uncertainty on the way phi varies with time, which means that the instant after, the value of phi will be infinitely large. So the only way to have a well approximated classical field is to have a coherent state for the field itself, which minimizes the uncertainty on the value of the field and the phi dot, the variation of the field in time. And that will last long. Indeed, you notice that the expectation value of the field, you remember, in the harmonic oscillator, the expectation value of x for a coherent state was related to if the coherent state was E produced by E to the I lambda A dagger out of the vacuum, has to do with lambda. In this case, the vacuum expectation value of the field itself would be J, which plays the role of lambda. And indeed, the classical field is proportional to J. So basically, the larger J, the more you excite your harmonic oscillator. But your harmonic oscillator here is the field. And indeed, the size of the classical field you produce is proportional to the source, which is J. So J creates, as the time evolves, you have a state which is the vacuum, turn on and off J. At a certain point, J will start producing particles in a clever way. The state will be not an Eigen state of particles, but will be a coherent state of different number of particles, which recreate an approximate classical field, which is the classical field that evolved inside the future light cone of the source. And on average, we'll have a value which is reproduced by the classical value of the field for that source.
This state is actually a superposition of different states having different number of particles. So suppose that we calculate the probability amplitudes for different number of particles and calculate the probabilities for this state to have certain number of particles. Then is it true that that probability distribution will be Poisson distribution?
Yes. Yes, because the distribution is exactly given by this.
Okay.
So this perfectly corresponds to emergence of particles and then they disappear after a very short time.
No, the particle will stay there. The source is you start producing particles, the source is off, and this particle, from this moment on, you'll get back the Hamiltonian without J. J turns off. And you'll be left with the non-trivial state. So the final state at large time is given now by this, which is not the vacuum.
Can we find a J function such that this state is an eigenstate of the number of it?
You want a J that is an eigenstate. You cannot do it, of course, with a J that is localized in space and time. Because a well-defined number of, or sorry. No, you cannot do it. You always get this form for any J.
Unless J is zero. Huh? Then the number of particles is zero.
Yeah.
Then that's pretty good.
Test source. So the understanding of classical fields and the relation between fields and particles is basically encoded in this picture. And it's similar to the relation between a quantum harmonic oscillator and a classical oscillator. If you want a quantum harmonic oscillator which behaves classically, you need to excite the harmonic oscillator at levels that are much, much larger than the zero-point energy, so that you can neglect quantization of levels. Right? And at that point, you have evolution, and you need not to be on a stationary state, of course, which is the equivalent of Eigen state of the number operator in particles.
Why do we always consider the source to be localized at certain
points? for two reasons: simplicity of calculation and the fact that in physics usually things are localized in space and time. Otherwise, you would start creating infinite energies. And, so typically, whenever you have a situation with large occupation numbers, which means large number of particles, which are all on top of each other, this corresponds to, from the field point of view, to have a large occupation number for the analog harmonic oscillator, and the state will become more and more classical-like. Exactly like in the harmonic oscillator, if you go to very high occupation number, eventually the harmonic oscillator will start behaving classically, unless you tune the state to be on an eigenstate of the image. So if you want, this is a transition to, in field cases, this is a transition to having a classical electromagnetic field or seeing the photons, the particle that made electromagnetic field one by one. If you increase the intensity of the field, you're increasing the size phi of the field, it's like increasing the number of photons that you have. If you put a lot of photons one on top of each other, the system behaves like a classical field. If you start reducing the intensity of the field, then you'll get starting to see the single photon itself, and the system will now behave more like a particle.
In ordinary quantum mechanics, we have the Hilbert spaces that we have are, you know, generally not infinite dimensional. So we can, for example, if you have a spin two system,
if you have a compass system.
Okay. So then in that particular case, we can say that observables are Hermitian operators.
Yes.
But in quantum field theory, it is not the case.
No, first of all, also in quantum mechanics, there is cases where you have an infinite Hilbert space, for example, position operators in infinite Hilbert space, and still the observable are Hermitian operators.
So what is the criteria that when can we represent the observable as Hermitian operators, and when we can't do that?
No, this is an axiom of quantum mechanics. Observable are always Hermitian operators.
Then it should mean that, for example, in the case of scalar fields,
yes.
For example, we have a complex scalar field.
Yes.
Then observables are the field itself, is the field itself, or is it just a combination of phi dot phi?
Observable are Hermitian operator, but you can write also the field itself in terms of Hermitian operators, because you can write phi, a complex field, as a near combination of real fields.
Okay.
And you can measure the real part and the imaginary part of the field are Hermitian operators.
Okay.
So one thing is the complexity in field, and one thing is the complexity in the operator that represents the field.
Okay.
The fact that the field is complex doesn't mean that it's not represented by Hermitian operator.
Okay. And whenever the field, whenever the observables are Hermitian, it necessarily means that the eigenstates of that particular observable correspond to a complete set of states. So we can express any vector in Hilbert space in terms of those eigenstates.
Yes.
Okay.
There are cases where the observables can be non, the operators corresponding to those may be non-Hermitian, right? Like when you have loss of some process, like loss of information or things like that.
Yes, that also the Lagrangian will describe a system that is not closed, will not be unitary. Well, it will not be Hermitian, so the evolution will not be unitary. But if you want to construct a theory of quote unquote everything, you don't want to have open system theory to be closed. So, let me finish with this. Last comments. You can also study the, in this system, you can also study the Hamiltonian. Because we have a Lagrangian that is explicitly x dependent, now we broke Poincaré. In particular, we broke, for example, time translation, because the source switch on and off. Then Hamiltonian will not be conserved anymore, will not be constant anymore. So the energy will not be conserved. In fact, you can compute the how the Hamiltonian, the expectation value of the Hamiltonian evolved with time. At time before the source turn on, the Hamiltonian, if for example we subtract this piece, will just give you zero on the vacuum, right? Because just have zero particle. But after the source is turned on and off, a later time, you'll get a non-trivial contribution from this part here, J star J, on the vacuum. So the Hamiltonian at T less than T source will be zero on the vacuum, but at time after the source is turned on, we'll give a non-trivial result, which is some integral in 3P, blah, 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 some J on the square. So really the source injected energy into the system by creating particles. And this is consistent with the fact that our Lagrangian was not time translation invariant. In fact, in the evolution of the state here, this is nothing else that if you expand it, well, it's a sort of trivial. If you expand this thing, this was e to the I h interaction dt. And if you expand this guy, you'll get 1 plus 10, which have 8 daggers. So, as you see, as time evolves, the evolution itself starts creating particles out of the vacuum. And increase the energy of the system. I think I'll stop the discussion of this example here. A little bit slow. I'll stop here maybe. Otherwise, I'll take more than 20 minutes. So, only thing left to discuss for scalar fields are the complex case. So I'll do tomorrow. And then we will start spin one up.